Welcome to Digital Church from the East Solent and Downs Methodist Circuit in Southern England. I'm David Muskett. I'm the Superintendent Minister in the circuit. You're very welcome. We're pleased that you've joined us and we hope that you'll get in touch. There'll be details of how to do that on the screen at the end of the service. We begin with our call to worship. Come to the God who knows us, to the God who created our being, to the God who knows our frailty, to the God who loves and cherishes us beyond measure. Come as you are and worship God. We're going to do that in song with the song, Lord, I lift your name on high. I love to sing your praises. We continue in worship with prayers of praise and confession. Let us pray. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and his compassion is over all that he has made. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your faithful shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and tell of your power. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. We long for the fire of God's cleansing to touch our unclean lips, for our guilt to be removed and our sin wiped out. So we meet Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, seeking forgiveness. Each time I say, Lord, be merciful, you might like to respond, forgive us our sin. Lord God, our Maker and our Redeemer, this is your world and we are your people. Come among us and save us. We have willfully misused your gifts of creation. Lord, be merciful, forgive us our sin. We have seen the ill treatment of others and have not gone to their aid. Lord, be merciful. Forgive us our sin. We have condoned evil and dishonesty and failed to strive for justice. Lord, be merciful. Forgive us our sin. We have heard the good news of Christ, but have failed to share it with others. Lord, be merciful. Forgive us our sin. we have not loved you with our heart, or nor our neighbours as ourselves. Lord, be merciful. Forgive us our sin. To all and to each, where regret is real, God pronounces pardon and grants us the right to begin again. Thanks be to God. Amen. We continue in adoration with some verses from Psalm 103. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and do not forget all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquity. The Lord is merciful and gracious. He will not always accuse, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his steadfast love towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far he removes our transgressions from us. Merciful God, your Son came to save us and bore our sins on the cross. May we trust in your mercy and know your love, rejoicing in the righteousness that is ours through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Continuing in worship and on that theme of God's mercy, we sing the hymn, There's a Wideness in God's Mercy, Like the Wideness of the Sea.
Our reading is from Matthew chapter 18, reading verses 21 through to 35. Then Peter came and said to him, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times? Jesus said to him, "Not seven times, but I tell you 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared with a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him, and as he could not pay, his lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children and all his possessions and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything.' And out of pity for him, the lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, 'Pay what you owe.' Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you.' But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he should pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, 'You wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you?' And in anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until he should pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart." Thanks be to God.
So let's pray. Father, I pray that you would take my words and make them yours, that each of us would hear from you. Amen. I wonder if you've ever had anyone sin against you. There are all sorts of ways someone might have said or done something to upset you, offend you, or hurt you in one way or another. Whatever it was, it means that the relationship between you isn't what it was. In some way, that has been damaged or broken. It may be that you're now always wondering what they're going to say, or they might have done something that means you're never quite sure if you can trust them. They might have leapt to an incorrect conclusion and posted derogatory comments about you on social media, or criticised you in public when a quiet word would have been enough. I don't know what it was, but I suspect there's no one who hasn't ever had someone sin against them. It's where the other person in the relationship does or says something to damage that relationship. You'll have noticed that our translation of that passage in Matthew 18 has Peter asking Jesus about a member of the church who sins against him. I suspect that a more correct word might have been brother, for which we would now want to say brother or sister. And Peter is supposed to have asked this question. The church had not begun yet. Jesus had promised that Peter would be the rock on which it was to be built. Perhaps Peter was speculating on relationships in the yet-to-be-started church. Perhaps that's a level of interpretation from the translators. Perhaps it was an interpretation that Matthew intended. It's another question that I'll want to ask someone in heaven, though it probably won't seem important then. It may be that Peter was asking about forgiving his brother Andrew when he publicly insulted him over a disagreement about their fishing business. Or it might be that he was wondering how to handle Nathaniel or Mary Magdalene or one of the others who seemed persistently to be undermining his authority as the rock on which the church was to be built. Maybe. It's interesting to speculate, but probably not fruitful. When I asked at the beginning if anyone had sinned against you, did you think of your brother or sister or a member of your family? Or did you think of a colleague or friend or someone from church? Whoever you thought of, and whoever Peter was thinking of, the point is that sooner or later, when you deal with Jesus, you have to come to the F word. This is about forgiveness. We'll come to the numbers in a moment, but firstly, we need to get our heads around the nature of forgiveness, what it is, what it isn't, how it works, from us and for us. So firstly, a bit of what forgiveness isn't. It's not simply the same as forgetting something, letting it go, and not even noticing that something happened. In the other direction, forgiveness also rules out vengeance and retribution, or getting your own back. Someone has said that the policy of an eye for an eye eventually leaves everyone blind. That doesn't describe forgiveness. Forgiveness rules out vengeance and getting even, but it doesn't rule out being clear about your feelings or the offence that has been caused. At the end of our prayers of confession a few moments ago, we had a good definition, as far as I can remember, as good a definition. God pronounces pardon and grants us the right to begin again. Pronouncing pardon acknowledges that there is something to pardon, that a wrong had been done. Granting the right to begin again says that although there has been damage done to the relationship, we can start again. We can move on from here without that getting in the way. Someone else wants to find forgiveness as allowing the other person to live. And he just didn't just mean that you'd stop short of killing them. You wouldn't restrict them, but you'd allow them their life. Forgiveness wipes the slate clean, doesn't deny that there was ever anything on it, but doesn't carry it forward either. Peter was asking about how much forgiveness he has to give out. Jesus realised the connection between the forgiveness we expect to receive and the forgiveness we feel we should give. The story Jesus told is full of his characteristic exaggeration to make his point. The 10,000 talents owed by the first slave is an unimaginable amount of money. It's the largest imaginable quantity of the largest possible denomination of money. It's the sort of amount that we calculate government debt in, since all the borrowing to pay for measures in response to coronavirus. No individual could contemplate being in that kind of debt. The debt that he was owed by the second slave is not inconsiderable. 100 denarii comes to just under a third of a year's wages for the lowest paid. Something under £10,000 in today's money. Not inconsiderable, but tiny by comparison. Jesus is telling a story to show that the forgiveness we can expect is related to the forgiveness we give out. It's put in summary form in the Lord's Prayer. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. It's worth remembering that doesn't mean forgive us our sins because we forgive those who sin against us, but forgive us our sins in the same way as we forgive those who sin against us. We can expect to get the kind of forgiveness we offer. So if you don't forget the debt, if you don't forgive the debt, the sin, the insult that is significant to you, you can't expect to be forgiven for the massive ways that you've offended someone else, or the ways in which your words, actions, and attitudes continually remove God from his rightful place of honour in all aspects of life and replace him with you and your ego. Maybe that sounds a bit harsh. Maybe I also exaggerate to make a point, but perhaps you get what I mean. In a way, it can be seen as a bit like breathing. Try this one with me. Breathe in. Now breathe in. Oh, you can't do that, can you, till you've breathed out. There is no capacity to take in until you've given out. Similarly, it seems that God can't forgive us until or unless we forgive others. Actually, I'm not sure about the can't, but it seems that he doesn't or won't, because we're meant to be in his image. Just continually taking in forgiveness without the requirement to give it out will never enable us to grow into people of forgiveness and grace. So what about the frequency? Is 7 times enough? Seems pretty generous, really. It's more than the rabbis were suggesting in Peter's day. And again, Jesus is exaggerating for effect. The number he quotes is variously translated as 77 times or 70 times 7. Whether that's 77 or 490 is neither here nor there. You remember the person who'd sinned against you that you thought of at the beginning? How many times have you forgiven them? The right answer would be, I don't know, I haven't been counting. Jesus is saying, how many times you should forgive your brother, your sister, a member of the church? Don't even think about counting. That's not the way your Heavenly Father goes about forgiveness. If you start counting, you're not really forgiving. God will always answer the prayer to forgive us in the same way as we forgive others. To all and to each, where regret is real, God pronounces pardon and grants us the right to begin again. Thanks be to God. Amen. So we come to our prayers, an opportunity to pray for ourselves and one another, for people, places and situations that are on our minds at the moment, for family, friends and neighbours, any whom we know who are sick, and for those who care for them, whether in hospitals, homes or communities. We pray for those whom we know who've been returning to work or school or college, for the staff, for those who have no work to return to, and those seeking new jobs. We pray too for those in positions of power, influence and authority, those who have the responsibility for decisions in their organisations, their companies, or for the country. Decisions that affect the lives and livelihoods of others. Spend some time in quiet for you to pray in your own way for whatever's on your heart and mind at the moment. Father, we thank you for your care, your mercy and compassion, for all that you have made, for all your people. We pray that we may know your presence, your comfort, that those for whom we've prayed may know your healing touch, your wholeness, your compassion, your prompting and your leading. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. We draw our prayers together in the prayer for the coming of the kingdom, as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. When we pray, it can be a dangerous thing. So often we may be asked to be a part of the answer to our prayers. We reflect that in the hymn that's known as the Prayer of St. Francis, "Make me a channel of your peace." Finally, we ask God's blessing on us as we go on into the rest of this day and the week to come. Go forth into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honour everyone. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among us and remain with us and those we love and all for whom we pray, today and always. Amen. Amen. Thank you for joining us today. There will be, in a moment, details of how you can contact us at the East Solent and Downs Methodist Circuit in Southern England. Hope to see you next week.